Hello, I'm Markus Brinkmann.
And I'm Juraj Sumarowski.
And we are here to present to you Alpaca Application Layer Protocol Confusion, Analyzing and Mitigating Cracks in TLS Authentication. This is a joint research effort of Christian Dresen, Robert Merget, Damian Podebniak, Jens Müller, Jörg Schwenk and Sebastian Schinzel.
Okay, thank you, Markus. So today we are going to talk about transport layer security and attacks on transport layer security. So the TLS protocol is the most important cryptographic protocol which allows us to secure connections, for example, between a browser and a web server. So in order to protect the connections from the man-in-the-middle adversaries, we use transport layer security. In such a scenario, we connect to a server which uses a certificate. For example, in this case, it could be a certificate for blackhat.com, and we can be sure that we are speaking to this service. In order to validate this, we can take a look at the certificate that is published on a domain and validate that it was indeed published by a valid certificate authority and which validated the server for blackhat.com. So if we use transport layer security is located between the transport and application layer in the TCP/IP stack. This means that it allows us to protect any application protocol. For example, not only HTTP, but also SMTP, FTP, POP3, IMAP, and so on and so on. So it can be used to secure any protocol that is located on the application layer. This is also highlighted in the TLS 1.2 standard, which says that one advantage of TLS is that is application protocol independent. Higher layer protocols can layer on top of TLS transparently. And for this, the decisions on how to initiate the TLS handshaking and how to interpret the authentication certificates, each change between the server and the client are left to the judgment of the designers. So we do not know, so we have to somehow validate or establish policies which allows us to validate the protocol that we are talking to. One such policies can be implemented by X509 certificates. So as already mentioned, we used X509 certificate for blackhat.com, and if we analyze it, then we can see that there is a field which says that it is an SSL server certificate, and it has specific extensions which mentions that it is a WW server authentication certificate. It also mentioned that it is issued for SNI cloudflare.com, so this is probably a server that hosts blackhat.com, and in order to also validate blackhat.com domains, there is an certificate subject alternative name extension that mentions that the certificate is valid for asterisk blackhat.com or for blackhat.com. This is an example of a multi-domain as well as a wildcard certificate that is commonly used in practice. So what we have to notice here is that IP address and port are not protected by TLS and not by the certificates. So this leads us to our basic attack scenario. So imagine that we have a browser which attempts to connect to www.bank.com, and it sends a GET request there. And we can assume that we are using up-to-date browser which implements same origin policy. It uses some HTTP security headers, for example, content security policy, HSTS, X-frame options. So the attacker which is targeting this connection has no chance. However, what a man-in-the-middle attacker could do, for example, if there would be a different server using POP3 protocol, what the attacker could do is to redirect the GET request triggered by the client to the POP3 server. The client would still connect to this server because the POP3 server uses a compatible certificate which was issued for asterixbank.com. And the question is now, what happens if such a request is issued to the POP3 server, and can we somehow exploit it as an attacker? So this leads us to three research questions. So what is the impact of such cross-protocol attacks today? And if there is an impact, so how many servers are affected by cross-protocol attacks? And third, how can we protect, how can we prevent such cross-protocol attacks? So in this talk, we are going to first introduce the basic idea and the attacker scenario behind cross-protocol attacks. Then we will get a bit deeper into attack methods and into our evaluation. And last but not least, we will discuss countermeasures against these attacks. So the general attack works like this. Imagine the client wants to establish a TLS channel to the intended server S. And we are assuming that the S attacker has some way to control the channel and how is it established and what type of request is made. This can be, for example, done if the attacker triggers a GET request using JavaScript. Then we assume that there is a man-in-the-middle attacker who can redirect the connection to some substitute server T. And if the certificate between T and S, so between two servers, application servers, is compatible, then this connection is also established. Now the attacker can try to exploit some behavior in the new server T that is unexpected by the client to subvert the application security of the server S. So in order to do this, we developed or summarized three attack methods which allow you to perform such attacks. In our work, we concentrate on web-based attacks. So we assume that we have a browser and we try to exploit some cross-site scripting attacks or steal some sensitive data like cookies. So for this purpose, we first assume a so-called reflection attack, which is similar to reflected accesses. In this case, we assume that the attacker is able to trigger a GET request, for example, with a script which executes some JavaScript, and this request is triggered to an HTTP server. We assume that the attacker is able to redirect this request to an FTP server, and we use the behavior of the FTP server to reflect this content, and we retrieve a reflection attack. The second attack we call a download attack. So we assume that the attacker is able to trigger a specific request which tries to retrieve some stored data from the FTP server. This request is sent initially to an HTTP server, however, the attacker redirects it to an FTP server, which then sends back a file which was stored on the FTP server and which contains, for example, HTTP commands and some script execution, and which is hopefully or potentially executed by the browser. And in the last attack, what we do, we call it upload attack, which concentrates on the stealing of cookies, for example, or other sensitive data. We assume that the attacker triggers a GET request, and if the victim is logged in to a server, automatically this GET request also embeds a cookie into the request. The attacker then tries to redirect this request and in order to FTP server, so that the FTP server retrieves this file or retrieves this request and stores it on the FTP server. Then the attacker is able to retrieve this request as a file on the FTP server. The attacks that I just generally introduced have several obstacles. As already mentioned in my introduction, we need to assume that both servers that we want to exploit use compatible certificates. The second obstacle or prerequisite is that the server that we would like to exploit use TLS compatible versions or cipher suites or cryptographic primitives, which are accepted by modern browsers. Third, we assume that the application protocol somehow offers possibility for one of these three attacks. Last but not least, we need to consider also protocol noise that is constructed by sending, for example, a post or get request, which introduces some HTTP commands, which are not necessarily understood by FTP or SMTP servers, and the same applies to the way back to the client. So if we retrieve some reflection or some kind of response from the FTP or from SMTP server, it typically contains some protocol noise or invalid commands which are not understood in by the modern browsers, and this is and what will be introduced now by Markus, so how we were able to exploit this in our attack methods.
Cross-protocol attacks on HTTP without TLS have a long history in the pentesting community. The first was published by Jochen Topf's HTML form protocol attack in 2001. The first attack that involves TLS, to our knowledge, is an example for a cross-protocol attack on HTTP against an FTP server given by Jan Horn with input from Michal Zalewski in 2015. This attack is marked with a red asterisk in the table. So in this work, we wanted to look at more protocols. So we also considered cross-protocol attacks on HTTPS exploiting email protocols, SMTP, IMAP, POP3, and we also still looked at FTP servers today. Note that the number of these cross-protocol scenarios grows quadratically with the number of protocols and the number of implementations secured by TLS. So most scenarios are unexplored and are an invitation to the community to find more cross-protocol attacks. So here's a description of the first of the two attacks given by Jan Horn in 2015. He showed a reflected cross-site scripting attack using an exploitable FTP server. Here the victim visits an attacker-controlled website, and the attacker triggers a cross-origin HTTP request to the target web server, here bank.com, where the body contains valid FTP commands. The man in the middle attacker redirects this request to an FTP server with a compatible certificate. Here, we had chosen a wildcard certificate, asterisk.bank.com. The browser completes the TLS handshake with the FTP server and sends the HTTP request as application data. Now, the FTP server has to be error-tolerant, tolerant to the protocol noise. And then it will output errors for the HTTP header lines and execute the FTP commands in the body. An exploitable FTP server will then reflect the embedded JavaScript to the client in an error message that includes the JavaScript. Of course, this is dependent on the implementation of the FTP server. Some FTP servers reflect the JavaScript, some do not. So we have to look at the FTP servers in more detail later. And the browser processes the response from the FTP server as if it was an HTTP response. Of course, here it is not a valid HTTP response. It is missing the normal status response line and the headers. But sometimes an exploitable browser will find the JavaScript by content sniffing and execute it within the context of the original request, completing the reflection attack. So it's important to note here that the browser will execute the JavaScript in the context of the target domain bank.com, because the browser thinks it downloaded the web page from the intended web server. Here are some examples for reflection attacks that we actually found. The Microsoft FTP server reflects an argument to the lang command, which selects a language, Here, we didn't select a language, but we put some JavaScript where normally the language argument would be. And because this is a syntax error, the language is not supported. And which language is not supported is reflected in the response. So this JavaScript is then executed by the browser. Or here's an example from Kerio Connect IMAP server. There, we didn't find a reflection vector that allowed the double quote character. But you can use techniques that are known from cross-site scripting filtering bypasses to find some JavaScript that is reflected anyway. So the same techniques that are used in cross-site scripting can be applied here. And here's another example from SendMile SMTP server. There we couldn't use an argument to a command to reflect JavaScript, but we could use the position of the command itself. An unknown command is reflected, and then if we use JavaScript in place of where the command should be, the JavaScript is reflected and executed. So a second attack described by Jan Horn is a download attack. Now, this corresponds to stored cross-site scripting. Here's how it works. First, the attacker has to prepare a file on the FTP server that contains the JavaScript payload. You can see it in the bottom right corner here. And in the first HTTP request, the attacker prepares the target server, the application server, to make this file available for a download in a later second request. So the first request, the attacker opens a data port in the FTP server to download the file. So in FTP, you have to know there's a control port, and then on the control port, you execute FTP commands, and for each file that is downloaded, there's a separate data port. And this is another TCP/IP port that you have to connect to download the file. And here the response is discarded on the control port, because we are only interested in the side effect that the data port is opened. And of course, then the second request, which can be a normal web request, which is the result of changing the window location, is redirected to this data port, and the response from the data port is the pure file content without any protocol noise. So we can actually put a complete HTTP response there, which is then processed by the browser. And because there's no protocol noise in this response, there is protocol noise in the first response, which is discarded, but in this response there is no noise, and so this attack works in any browser. These attacks are completely generic and do not depend on implementation details. So here we can see again the FTP attack, where you have the commands that prepare an FTP server for a passive data connection and the retrieval of the stored file. And the stored file content would be, for example, like this complete web page, including the HTTP response header. There are other possibilities for download in other protocols. So for example, in POPS3 protocol and IMAP protocol, the attacker can download emails. In this case, the attacker has to have an email account at the POPS3 or IMAP server, and then he can prepare an email containing the JavaScript payload. And this email can then be downloaded using the commands you can see in this example. They are different in POPS3 and IMAP, but the general attack is the same. The attacker logs in with his own credentials and then instructs the IMAP or POPS3 server to provide in the response the email that is then used for the attack. So we contribute a third attack method, the upload attack. This attack method is very similar to the download attack. But the difference here is that the attacker now opens the data connection for the FTP server to upload a file. The basic mechanism is the same, but in this case we are not interested in responding to the web browser with JavaScript, but we are interested in what the web browser sends to the web server. And so in this case it's even simpler because the HTTP response is simply logged or saved to this file on the FTP server in the second request. And the second request also contains some cookies with secret login credentials by the user, for example. So also these upload vectors are completely generic for the application protocol. And here again is a complete example for the FTP upload. We have also examined how these upload attacks could be used with an SMTP or IMAP server. The difference with SMTP and IMAP in comparison to FTP is that these protocols do not use a separate data port for the upload. Instead, these protocols inline the uploaded data into the control connection. So the problem here is that the web browser will send the cookie before we actually prepare the server to accept an incoming email. And this is the problem because we need to send the cookie in a second request so that the cookie is actually part of the email data that is sent. But this requires that the browser reuses the same TLS connection for both HTTP requests. And in general, this is not the case because we are not sending a valid HTTP 1.1 response on the control port. Because of protocol noise, the browser decides that this is not an HTTP 1.1 compatible server. And then it will not reuse the connection, which would be the case with HTTP connection keep alive. So in this case, this attack remains completely theoretical. We could not get this to work in practice, but maybe there are some browsers which are vulnerable or some other protocols that can be attacked in this way. So we include this for completeness. So in summary, we are considering all these upload, download, and reflection attacks for all these protocols, FTP, SMTP, IMAP, and POP3. And of course, POP3 does not really provide any mechanism to upload data to the POP3 server. It is a pure email download protocol. And so we have to exclude this from consideration. And the same SMTP only allows to submit email. It's a submission protocol, and it does not allow to download email from an inbox. So here also we had to exclude the download attacks from consideration. All the other attacks we considered, and in some cases, of course, we did not find practical attacks, and in many others we did. So now we are looking at the evaluation. So we evaluated each individual precondition for a successful attack in isolation, and then we combined all the individual results to a complete attack. So for the protocol noise, a short reminder, we have the noise from the browser to the application server, which is not expecting an HTTP request. And we have the noise from the application server to the browser, which is expecting an HTTP response, but does not get it. And so we had to analyze these two protocol noises separately. For the noise tolerance in browsers, we tested if the browser would accept protocol noise on the channel. So in many browsers, those based on Chromium, Chrome, Edge, Firefox, Opera, and Safari, they are actually pretty strict. If they do not see a valid HTTP response, they will immediately fall back to some very specific compatibility mode where they are not executing any JavaScript but are simply presenting the response text as ASCII, for example. Or maybe they do not even actually show anything and just show an error message. So for these browsers, we could not perform many of the attacks that include protocol noise, in particular the email protocols. So, but we could get the FTP upload and download attack to work because they are free from protocol noise on the data port. Now, a different story is with Internet Explorer and the Edge legacy, because here we could actually get all attack methods to work because Internet Explorer is tolerant of protocol noise. It performs something called content sniffing. If it falls back to HTTP 0.9, it will actually search into the response for valid HTML and JavaScript and render and execute it. So this is very useful for these attacks, of course. It makes many of these attacks possible in the first place. Here's an example. Here we see the Internet Explorer, which is rendering the response from an FTP server that contains some JavaScript. In this case, it is a reflected JavaScript attack. And we can see that there are many error messages in the response. The FTP server could not understand many of the HTTP header lines. But eventually, it will come to the FTP payload in the body, and then it will execute the JavaScript. And you can also see here that it is in the context of the target domain. So for the other direction, the noise tolerance in servers, we evaluated 24 popular application servers across all protocols. So here is a complete list. We chose six application servers for each protocol, SMTP, IMAP, POP3, FTP, and we selected them based on a banner scan for popularity. And we tested tolerance for three things. We checked if they accept an HTTP request in the first line, which in our case is always a POST method. So, and then there will be more one or more lines with a key value pair for a normal HTTP header, additional metadata, including the cookie, of course. And some are actually filtering this, at least postfix is filtering these lines. And then we also checked how many syntax errors these implementations allow before they terminate the connection. And here we have two examples why the attack could not work. In postfix, there's very strict filtering for commands, and if it sees something that looks like an HTTP request, either based on the first line, which contains a POST, or on the other lines, which contain a key colon value line, then it will immediately close the connection. And another example would be mdaemon, which aborts the connection after three errors. We are assuming that this is not to detect HTTP requests, but because to filter out unwanted connections from arbitrary random clients that are connecting to SMTP ports and send up random data, for example. And in this case, it just terminates the connection, and this will also affect cross-protocol attacks. So if we put everything together and look at the complete attack, then for each of these 24 servers, we can ask the question if we can complete one of the attack methods involving these servers for at least one browser. And we found that 8 servers are exploitable with browsers vulnerable to content sniffing, which is the Internet Explorer, of course. And this would be one SMTP server, 3 IMAP servers, and 4 POP3 servers. We see that SMTP servers are generally more strict, and we think that this is because of they are more battle-hardened due to spamming and early cross-protocol attacks before TLS, where browsers could be used to send a spam. And there are also 4 servers exploitable in all browsers, and these are FTP servers with the upload and download method. And these, they also allow reflection attacks, but these reflection attacks only work in Internet Explorer. So in total, we can say that half of the application servers can be exploited for at least one attack method and with at least one browser. We implemented proof of concepts with a well-secured web server and an automated man-in-the-middle attacker. For details, you can look into the artifacts to our paper. Pause machen hier? Okay. To see how many servers can be affected by cross-protocol attacks, we did a complete IP4 scan for SMTP, IMAP, POP3, and FTP servers using TLS. So here you can see the results of our scan. First, we looked at servers that actually speak TLS, and then we filtered those which actually provide a valid certificate, because many servers are misconfigured. They can have self-signed certificates, they can have expired certificates, and so we had to look at least if it's a valid certificate. It does not need to be valid for the application server, because we will later look if it's valid for a web server, which is the only thing that interests us in our attack. But we have to have at least some valid certificate that is trusted by one of the major certificate authorities configured in the browser. So then we extracted from these certificates all the unique host names that are configured in the common name or in the subject alternative name extension. And all these host names we took into a huge bag of host names, and for these host names we wanted to see if there's an HTTP server also. Of course, we have to deal with wildcard certificates. There's an asterisk there, asterisk.bank.com, and we have to deal with this somehow. In this case, we guess www for the name of the web server in a subdomain of the wildcard domain. And now, if we scan port 443 on all these hostnames, we find web servers. We find many of them. And we find 1.4 million web servers that are paired with some application server that has a compatible certificate. So for all these web servers, we find some email or FTP server where we can confuse the connection and send the data that is intended for the web server to the application server. And in this case, we have already performed the general TLS cross-protocol confusion attack. So this does not mean we can exploit it, because we also need all the other preconditions, especially some way to download, upload, or reflect data. But it is at least one big step towards a complete cross-protocol attack. So if we look at it in more details from the internet scan alone, we do not know if the web server can actually be exploited. And of course, for ethical reasons, we could not try to exploit live web servers running on the internet. So we had to use a banner scan to try to identify which particular implementation was used. And based on that information, we extrapolated from our previous lab evaluation if this implementation could be exploitable by cross-protocol attack. And indeed, we found that depending on the actual attack method and server implementation and protocol, we found in total 114,000 web servers that we think can be exploited with one of the attacks demonstrated in our work. And then we looked back at one of the application servers and we counted them towards the total. So yes, now I'm handing back over to my colleague Juraj.
Okay. Thank you, Markus. So there is one more thing we wanted to tell you. So Alpaca attacks are also applicable without man-in-the-middle attackers. So how does it work? So in the previous examples, we assumed that there is always an attacker who triggers the connection to an HTTP server, and the attacker also has the man-in-the-middle capabilities, which allow the attacker to redirect the connection to an FTP server. However, in several cases, this is not necessary. And what the attacker can do, the attacker can directly trigger the request from the browser to the FTP server, for example, to blackhat.com at port 990. So this attack has several requirements. So the first one is that the application server port is not blocked by the browser. So this is, for example, the case for FTPS server on port 990, which is not blocked by Internet Explorer. The second prerequisite is that the host name has to be the same. And the third prerequisite is that the browser ignores port in the same origin policy security mechanisms. This is a typical case for an Internet Explorer. So this Alpaca without man-in-the-middle attacks attackers was applicable especially in cases where Internet Explorer was used. We notified the developers, and Internet Explorer introduced patches in June 2021. And for this purpose, it blocked more ports, and also it introduced or disabled HTTP content sniffing on several non-standard ports. Other major browsers have also introduced similar countermeasures or will also block more ports. So these attacks were in particular applicable to different servers like MailFence or Bitcoin Stack Exchange websites, or maybe the government of India's webmail service, and so on and so on. So until now, we talked only about the attacks. So how about the countermeasures against these attacks? So often, the response to cross-protocol attacks in the wild was to detect and prevent them at the application layer. Here we saw three common strategies. So the first one on the left, what we can see that the postfix server detect dangerous protocols and followed the invalid requests by terminating the connection. So what we can see here is that the postfix server answers with an error, "I can break rules too," after retrieving a GET request. The second possible countermeasure that we saw is to terminate the connection after too many syntax errors. So for example, Exim terminated the connection after too many invalid lines. So for example, from the GET request, what you can see, the first GET line, then the host line with the value bank.com, and so on and so on. And after too many unrecognized commands, the failure is responded and the connection is terminated. The third one is to reflect or to avoid a reflection of specific attack vectors. And this was the case in the Sendmail server, which simply rejected or avoided reflection of attack vectors like script alert one. Any of these changes can be seen as good countermeasures. However, they can cause also interoperability issues with legitimate clients. We note also that these mitigations only apply after authentication and protocol confusion has happened. So bypasses still might be possible before these countermeasures are applied. And also, they cannot prevent unknown cross-protocol attacks methods that were not published yet. Another potential approach would be to restrict certificates to be valid for only one service based on the server name. In practice, this means that no wildcard, no multi-domain certificates can be used, and that every service has to be located on a distinct hostname. In particular, this last requirement means that a change would not be transparent to clients, raising major compatibility problems. Also, we have observed that there are still many wildcard certificates which are used on the real-world servers, and there is still some necessity to use them. The last maybe invalid countermeasure or inappropriate countermeasure that we'd like to highlight is the usage of extended key usage extension in the X509 certificates. This is what we have already discussed at the beginning of the talk, as we took a look at the certificate used by blackhat.com. This certificate has a specific extension indicating that the certificate can be used for WW server authentication and client authentication. This would maybe suggest that this certificate can only be used for HTTP servers or for specific connections on the web, and that there are specific extended key usage extensions for FTP, SMTP, or other server protocols. However, this is not the case. So if you take a look at YANA numbers and at RFC 52080, then we can see that there are only a handful of extended key usage extension values that we can use. In particular, we can use WW server authentication and client authentication. We can use extensions for defining code signing, email protection, like in the case of SMIME protocol, timestamping or OCSP. So there is no simple way to define specific extended key usage extension for SMTP, FTP, or other protocols. And basically what we have observed is that WW server authentication extensions is a typical extension that is used also for all the servers independently of the application layer. So to conclude, these X509 extensions only differentiates between client and server on the web, and no application protocol distinction is possible. So what are the possible countermeasures that we can apply?
So we have found that there are two TLS extensions which can be used to implement countermeasures to cross-protocol attacks. The first is Application Layer Protocol Negotiation, or short ALPN. This allows a client to specify a list of intended protocols during the handshake phase. The server selects one of these protocols, or if it does not support any of them, as is the case in cross-protocol attacks, it must terminate the connection. If servers implement the strict ALPN verification for all clients that use ALPN, all the concrete attacks that we reported in our work would be prevented, because the browsers are already using ALPN to negotiate different versions of HTTP. To preserve legacy compatibility with other clients, the servers can still accept connections from clients without ALPN. When clients and servers use strict ALPN verification, their connections would be protected from all possible cross-protocol attacks. Now, as a second option, server name indication allows the client to specify the intended hostname of the server during the TLS handshake. And if the server recognizes the hostname, it completes the handshake. Otherwise, it can terminate the connection. Implementing strict SNI verification in the server would prevent at least some cross-protocol attacks and even some same-protocol attacks involving servers located on different hostnames. This can be used as a defense adept or when ALPN is not available. However, we note that SNI fallback in the case of an unrecognized hostname is a very common configuration in web servers, and this fact is unlikely to change due to compatibility concerns. This was already reported by Delignard-Labo et al. In their 2015 article on virtual host confusion attacks. Now, we collected information for developers how to configure strict ALPN and SNI verification in many popular TLS libraries. If you are responsible for an application server protected by TLS and want to implement countermeasures against our attacks, you can find more information on our webpage. So in this work, we wanted to answer a number of practical questions. Are cross-protocol attacks still possible today? How many web servers are affected by them? And how can they be prevented? We found that these attacks indeed are still possible today. And we also found 114,000 web servers with an exploitable FTP or email server that has a compatible certificate. We also found good countermeasures. Strict ALPN and SNI can prevent these attacks completely and at the cryptographic layer. So for the future, we would like to see more cross-protocol attacks, especially including binary protocols and other secure channel implementations such as DTLS and IPsec. Thank you for listening, and we are now open for questions. You can visit our website and contact us on Twitter @LambdaFu and Jura Zumorowski.
Okay, thank you very much.